ago, Larry had entitled his message Victory, which is the title that I had initially planned for today. So I had to change my title a little bit, so it's now The Ultimate Victory. A lot of the things that Larry had in his message, some of those will be prerequisites, and some of those will be some points that we probably will both touch on, because both of us are looking at what is and will be the ultimate victory. Before we begin, let's bow for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, such a beautiful, glorious day. We celebrate our resurrected Lord. And Father, to each Christian, that is such an important event because it truly shows that you have given us the ultimate victory. You have given us life over death. And so, Father, as we recount some of your plan, some of the points along the way, we always look forward to that ultimate victory when we will share our heavenly home with you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Sporting events bring lots of victories. I don't know how many of you stayed up last night to watch the second basketball game. I really thought UCLA was going to restart a dynasty. A lot of you are old enough to remember the wooden years when UCLA was the epitome of basketball. It lasted for several years, but then it faded, and another team took over. But I really was disappointed. I couldn't believe Gonzaga got that half-court shot off and didn't win it. But anyway, sports victories are passing. There are others that come along and pass them by. Some of us are probably old enough to remember the early 1950s and Roger Bannister. If the name is not familiar to you, Roger Bannister had the distinction of being the first runner to run the mile in under 4 minutes. 3 minutes, 59 seconds and change. And at the end of the race, he was really done in. But a sportscaster came up and asked him, he says, "What do you feel like?" And he says, "I feel like an exploded light bulb." He had given his all to accomplish that feat. But even that feat, at the time, no one will ever break the 4 minute mile again. But since that time, it has been broken multiple times. Satan thought he had the victory over Jesus. As Walt mentioned in his meditation, Satan probably was rejoicing because he was thinking Jesus was dead and there would be no more opposition. But that was not the plan. As we go back through the scriptures, starting off, to have a victory, there's got to be a plan. God had a plan. We don't know exactly how all of it started, but we know that when God created man, his foreknowledge knew that man would eventually sin. He knew that man would fall. And so God created a plan so that when man fell, there would be a way to redeem him. Garden of Eden was the beautiful spot. Man did not have to work. When they were hungry, they could go pick of the fruit of the tree and the bushes that were in the garden. An easy life of leisure. And everything was fine. But God said, "There's one tree I don't want you to eat from." And you know what happens when somebody tells you, "Don't do this." First thing you do is try to figure out a way to do it and not get caught. When your mom set the cookie jar up on the counter and says, "Don't get into the cookies before dinner," you didn't want to let her know that you were sneaking a cookie before dinner. on time. I'm not going to go there. I got caught. I'll just leave it at that. But God didn't want to leave man without hope. And even in the third chapter of the book of Genesis, we read that even though man had sinned, Satan had bruised the heel of man, or woman as the translation says, but the woman's seed would bruise the head of the serpent. And that was a foretelling that there was going to be some time down in the future when God would give man that opportunity to be redeemed. Throughout the Old Testament, we have numerous prophecies. And I'm not going to take the time to read all of them, but there are numerous prophecies throughout the Old Testament that give us a little bit of a preview of what was to come. Probably some of the greatest prophecies are in the book of Isaiah. We're familiar with the 7th chapter of Isaiah, where it tells that Jesus would be born of a virgin. We're familiar with the 9th chapter of Isaiah, which also tells us that Jesus would have an everlasting kingdom, that there would be no end to it, that he would be a descendant from the throne of David. Psalms give us many examples. Psalms give us the example of the crucifixion and that Jesus was going to be tried and all that he went through with that. And you can pick out just numerous prophecies. The book of Micah tells us where Jesus is going to be born. And in the 5th chapter, we read that thou Bethlehem of Ephrathah, though thou be small, thou shalt be great. And so all through the scriptures, God has his plan that is slowly unfolding. It had to be hard on the Israelite people to know that the Messiah was going to come, and yet he hadn't come in their lifetime. I'm not going to go into a whole lot of Old Testament history. A lot of people don't care that much for history. It's interesting. I enjoy it, but just because I like it doesn't mean you do. But all through the Old Testament, God is laying the foundation and the framework to bring about the final plan, the ultimate victory. Part of the preparation had to do with getting things ready. And each of the prophets tried to bring the people back to a focus on God. Because so many times, it was interesting in Sunday school class this morning, Ernie kept talking about roller coaster, up and down, up and down. But that's exactly what was going on with the Israelite nation. They would have a good king and they would fear God. Then they would have a bad king and they would go to idol worship. Then there would be a good king and they'd come back. And it was just up and down. And even going back to the Red Sea, when Moses led the people out, how could you not understand and appreciate the power of God to not only lead by a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire, but to part the sea and then to allow it to go back over and basically eliminate the Egyptian army that was in pursuit? And all of these miracles that God had done for them, how could they be so blind? But unfortunately, even today, people are blind to the miracles and the wonder of Jesus Christ. But getting back into preparation, there had to be a way of getting it to the people. And so even in the book of Malachi, we read that God was going to send a forerunner. This was John the Baptist. And if you've got time, turn to the book of Luke, first chapter, and read about Zechariah and John. Quite an interesting story. Because the Jewish family, they had to have a family name. And nobody in Zechariah's family had ever been named John. Zechariah had an encounter with an angel. Zechariah didn't think that he was going to name his child John, but he was told. Because of his disbelief, he was struck dumb. So he actually had to write on a piece of paper when the baby was born, his name is John. And then Zechariah was able to speak again, but it was interesting. God put that in place, and he brought John the Baptist in to start sharing the message that there was a Redeemer that was coming that was even closer than with the Old Testament prophecies. And so John the Baptist started. And you can read of his accounts in a couple of the Gospels. But John was what we would call a harbinger, a forerunner of the one to come. John was the one that was preparing the way, make paths straight, be ready to accept the Savior when he gets here. And so John was preaching for forgiveness and repentance, but it really wasn't going to be fulfilled until the time of Christ. And so John was out there preaching. He was drawing crowds, and they were getting ready. They knew something was coming. Weren't quite sure when or how, but they knew something was coming. The birth of Jesus was exciting. Remember when Mary found out that she was pregnant? First thing she did is she went to John the Baptist's mother, Elizabeth. And Elizabeth was pregnant. John hadn't been born yet. And Mary shared the good news with Elizabeth. And Elizabeth shared some news with Mary. And I'm sure they had their girl talk back and forth. But it was interesting when you read in the book of Luke again that Elizabeth says that when Mary was there, Elizabeth's own baby leaped for joy in her womb, knowing what was about to come. God's handprint on all of this. How often we don't realize the presence and the feelings that God puts together for us. Jesus was born. Not going to go through the Christmas story. We do that frequently. I'm sure everyone is quite familiar with the birth of Christ, how it came about. But Jesus started his ministry. And as he started his ministry started when he was 12 years old. If you remember, Mary and Joseph and Jesus had traveled to Jerusalem. They were going there to worship. They had done their services, done their worshiping, done their sacrificing. And they were started back home. And they had gone a day's journey. And all of a sudden, Mary and Joseph realized, hey, where's Jesus? Figuring he was probably with some of the other youths. They didn't worry too much about it, but then they started thinking, and asking, nobody knew where Jesus was. Traveled all the way back to Jerusalem, and where did they find Jesus? In the temple, discussing the law with the supposed learned people. And Jesus, at 12 years of age, was astounding them with his knowledge and understanding. And so Jesus' ministry, in my mind, really started when he was only 12 years old. But he was about 30 when he really started his ministry in earnest. This is when he called the 12 apostles. And again, you can read through the different passages, the book of Luke, 5th chapter, 6th chapter. You can read how he was walking along the sea, saw Peter and James, John, and later he called the others. And brought them all together. Matthew was about the last one that was called. But you can read the account of how he called them. Because Jesus knew that he himself needed more people to get the gospel further spread. And so he took the 12 men that he had chosen. Just kind of like to think what it might be like to have been chosen by Jesus to be a disciple, or in that case, an apostle. To sit at his feet and hear him explain some of the mysteries of God. But even to the apostles, the ministry of Jesus was more than they completely understood. For 3 years, they traveled with him. For 3 years, they were instructed. And yet they never really fully comprehended or understood what Jesus was trying to get across to them. They eventually developed that knowledge, most of them. Unfortunately, Judas was not one that ever comprehended until after the fact. And Judas was so remorseful, he went out and hanged himself. You can read about that, a little bit about that in a couple of different passages. Probably the little bit in Acts is most familiar to people. But his regret, went back to the temple, tried to give them back the money that they had given him to betray Jesus. And they did not want it. They spent it on what was called the potter's field for those that were too poor to be able to afford to bury their family or friends. And yet, with all of the instruction that Jesus gave to his apostles, they didn't fully understand. And today, people don't understand the great love of God. People don't understand the great gift of salvation that was given to us. They can't appreciate what Jesus went through for us. In the Old Testament, and I shared a verse of that last week from Leviticus, where it says the life was in the blood. And that's why a blood sacrifice was required. In the Old Testament, when the Passover was established, it was a blood sacrifice. Blood was shed on many cases when the death angel visited the land of Egypt. The firstborn were slain. Blood was shed. When the Israelites were celebrating their Passover, they were specifically told to sacrifice a perfect, unblemished lamb and to take, sprinkle the blood on the doorposts and lintels of the house, and that would be a sign for the death angel to pass by. It was the very blood of Jesus Christ at the crucifixion that was the sacrifice to enable the death of Satan's angels to not take us permanently. With any plan, not only do you have to implement it, not only do you have to share it with those that are going to be doing it, but there's got to be a way of carrying out this plan. And God covered that point also. Throughout the ministry, Jesus told many parables, many stories to try to help people understand what the kingdom of heaven was like, what was required of mankind to be able to enjoy that heavenly home, what to do as to how to treat their neighbors and their friends. Jesus brought a love into the world that was so much different than what was used to them, most people were used to. Jesus had what was considered an all-encompassing love. That means there was no respecter of persons. There was no one that was treated greater or lesser than anybody else. And it's so hard for us today to do that. We see people, and depending on how they're dressed and where they live and what they do, we immediately put them in little categories. And yet God does not put us in categories. You ever think what it might be like if God had put us in categories? Well, you did this sin, I'm going to stick you over there. I'm not going to pay much attention to you. Oh, you shared the gospel with somebody, I'll put you over here and I'll visit you a little while. Oh, you told somebody and you brought them to Christ and they were baptized, we'll put you over here and I'll come and visit you every week. God doesn't do that. God treats everyone the same. And Jesus' message, we should treat everybody with that same love that God had. We have a tendency to categorize. We look at different sins. Oh, this sin is terrible. We don't want to associate with them. This sin's not quite as bad, so we'll maybe fellowship with them. Or this person doesn't sin, they must be great. We categorize, and that is so alien, so foreign to the love that God wants us to have. Book of James, we read, we're not supposed to look at how a person is dressed. We're not supposed to put the well-dressed people in the front and the poorly dressed in the back. God says we are equal in His sight. Jesus used the apostles, tried to instill in them that love, tried to get them to understand. And that's what we need to understand today. We need to develop that encompassing love. Not the romantic love, but the genuine love, care, and concern. We want to help that person. We want them to know the joys of knowing Jesus. We want them to have that strength when difficult times in our lives come. It's only the power of God that enables us to be able to handle those difficult times. I don't know how people without Jesus can get through, because God will put his loving arms around you. You can feel his presence. And it's done not necessarily with just the arms of God around you, but he brings people to you. That hug, that handshake, that encouraging word. Those are signs that God's love is being shared and expressed to you. That's what gets people through difficult times. The plan was devised, the plan was shared, and now it was time to put the plan in place. It's hard to understand how Jesus would be willing, and again, as Walt mentioned in his meditation, Jesus didn't have to do that. He willingly went to the cross because he wanted to pay our debt of sin. We can read about the crucifixion in the different gospel accounts. And again, I'm not going to go through all these. I've listed most of these scriptures on your bulletin that you can look up at a later time. I would encourage you to take that time and look at some of those. The crucifixion. Jesus was an innocent man, but he had stirred up the religious leaders of the day. They didn't like the fact that Jesus was taking the people away from them. They were jealous that Jesus knew more. They were jealous that Jesus was able to heal, that Jesus was able to provide comfort, that Jesus was able to really share the love of God and help people understand what that was really like. They devised to kill him. They thought it was their plan. They thought they were the ones that were going to do all of this. But it was God's ultimate plan to allow Jesus to be sacrificed for our sins. When Jesus went before Pilate, even Pilate said, "I find no fault in this man." Took a basin, washed his hands in front of him, and said, "Let his blood be upon you." And the Jewish people that were in attendance, "Yes, we'll take his blood on us to our second and third generations, our children and children's children. We want him dead. We want him out of our lives." And they willingly did the deed. Pilate tried to appease them, but they were not to be appeased. And so Jesus was taken, beaten, scourged, mocked, the crown of thorns, the mocking, the scuffing, all the things. And Jesus did not answer. He sat there, took the punishment, took all that was thrown at him. And a lot of times we use the word meek. We think of it as somebody that is weak, when we are really meek people are strong. The meek are the ones that keep their emotions under control. They're the ones that don't lash out. They are the ones that, even when they're right, they endure, knowing it's for the better good. But Jesus meekly took all that was given, led out to Calvary, couldn't even carry the cross himself, and they had to get Joseph, Simon, I'm sorry, Simon to help carry the cross. Got him to the hill, nailed him physically to the cross. The pain of having nails driven through his hands and feet. I know anatomically people are going to tell you they couldn't put him in the palms of his hand, probably in the wrist, but still, he was nailed, physically nailed to the cross. Not just tied, not just hung there, but physically nailed. I can't imagine the pain that he was going through. Several years ago, we were out in Indiana, and we were going to build a new shed for storage for the church. So on the day that we were going to build it, there were probably 15 of the guys that came together, and each of us was going to do different parts and pieces of getting everything ready. We had a person that said they wanted to nail the sheeting in place, and they had a automatic nailer, power nailer. Well, they had never used one before, and they weren't sure how hard to set it. Unfortunately, one of the men standing inside the shed found out the hard way that not only did the nail go through the sheeting and the tube before on an angle because it wasn't straight, but it went into his arm. Barry was quite in distress. And that was just a small nail and a fleshy part of his arm. But Barry was complaining about the pain and how much it hurt for that nail to get into his hand like that. And so we had to take Barry over to the hospital. The nail, he wanted to pull it out, and we said, no, don't pull it out. Leave it there till we get to the hospital, because sometimes you don't know what it may have hit, and it may have been keeping his arm from bleeding. He could have bled out. We didn't know what it hit. So we left the nail in, got him to the hospital, and they took care of him. And Barry recovered okay. But it was the power of the gun shooting the nails that no one respected. And the pain that it brought to Barry was very difficult. And I'm trying to figure out how that pain may have been similar to what Jesus had when the nails were driven through his hands and feet. Barry said it was not pleasant, and I'm sure it wasn't. But that was one part, and to have multiple nails, multiple parts of the body nailed like that. But Jesus loved each one of us enough that he endured that for everyone. Everyone, not just the ones that come to church, not just the ones that are practicing religion, every person in the world, Jesus went to the cross for everyone. We have a responsibility to share that message with everyone. Don't write people off. Don't say this group isn't worth talking to. Whether they accept or not is their choice. But we have the responsibility to share with them. And if we don't share with them, who will? The ultimate victory was almost ready. Jesus died. It was interesting. It says, for 3 hours, the sun did not shine. 3 hours in darkness. God had turned his face away. He couldn't bear to see the sun suffering. It was a symbol of things to come also for those that don't believe. I can't imagine total, utter darkness. Closest I've ever been to that is several years ago, Sondra and I took a trip trip down to Kentucky, went to Cumberland Falls. We decided to go over to Cumberland Gap and see some of the sites there. After you go over the Cumberland Gap and start down, there is a cave called Cujo's Cave. I don't know if any of you have ever been there, heard about it, seen it. It was used by the Civil War, both sides, the South and the North. The South had it for a while, they used it as a hospital. The North captured it and they used it for some arms storage, but went back and forth between the North and South. But we took the tour to go into the cave. Well, as you go into the cave, everything is lighted. They've got little light bulbs every so many feet so that you can see. Only the guide has a flashlight. It's actually lantern-like. And we go into the cave and we get down way into it. Big room where they had used that area as their hospital when the South had it. And he says, just to give you an idea of what this was like, we're going to cut the lights. It literally was so dark, you could not see your finger or your hand in front of your face. You could actually touch your nose before you even knew where your hand was. That was complete darkness. Jesus tells us hell is going to be a place of darkness. It's going to be a place of torment. It's going to be a place where we can't see, where we're going to be in agony. But Jesus went to the cross to enable us to escape that punishment. The death occurred. The soldiers came by. Came to the body of Jesus, ready to break his legs. The scriptures in 4:12 that not a bone of his body would be broken. And so they didn't break the bones of Jesus. He had already died. Placed in a tomb, sealed with a great stone. Guards put at the tomb to make sure nobody stole the body. But that was no match for the power of God. Very early on the first day of the week, the women came to the tomb. On the way to the tomb, they were discussing how they were going to get the stone pulled away because they wanted to bring some spices to prepare the body better. When they got to the tomb, there were no guards. The stone was no longer covering the door. Also, as Walt mentioned, two angels, and depending on which gospel you read, there's some variations, but there were angels telling the women the tomb was empty, just as Jesus had promised. You can kill the body, but in 3 days, I will live again. The women didn't know what to think at first. The angel said, you see Jesus, he's not here. He's risen like he said. Go and tell his disciples. They did. Peter and John didn't believe him. I can just see Peter now. There's so many interesting stories about Peter. when Peter was in prison and Rhoda answered the door, people inside had been praying, and she tells them that Peter's there and they don't want to believe her. Standing out there by the gate, still wanting to get in. But Peter was the one that was always the first one to do something. John actually ran and got to the tomb before Peter, but John didn't go in. Peter was the one that went in first. And they saw the burial cloth in one spot, the face covering in another. The tomb was empty. God's ultimate victory over death. No longer was mankind going to be condemned to everlasting death because Jesus was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father. And because Jesus was raised from the dead, we have that hope of life with him. Jesus ministry for 40 days after the resurrection. During that time, he met with his disciples again. And there was one very interesting experience in the book of John. Most of you probably know where I'm going. Thomas was not with Jesus and with the disciples when Jesus first appeared. Thomas was called the doubter. Even though they were telling him that Jesus lived, he wouldn't believe it. He said, until I can put my hand and put my finger in the nail prints of his hand and touch his side, I won't believe. Later, the disciples were assembled and Jesus appeared to them. Jesus called out Thomas and he said, come hither. Put your finger in my hand. Feel my side. And Thomas immediately believed. And Jesus said, because you have seen and believed, you are blessed. But more blessed are those that have not seen and still believe. We may not have seen Jesus physically, but we have the evidence. We have the proof that not only was Jesus crucified, but that Jesus lives again. And we celebrate our Easter Sunday. I'd rather call it Resurrection Sunday or even Sunrise Sunday, because that is the day the ultimate victory was won. God's victory for you and me and every other person over death. The victory that God has promised us. Throughout life, we plan many things. Some people have bucket lists, but how often are they fully completed? God, in his knowledge, he planned, he prepared, and he executed the plan. And he won the ultimate victory for each and every person in this world. What are you doing to accept that victory that God has won for us? This could be a special time for some of you. You may not have made that choice to have Jesus as your personal Savior. But what better time than now to recognize Jesus won my victory. I want to be part of God's family. If you haven't made that choice, why wait? During life, we have every opportunity to make a choice. Once death happens, the choice is no longer ours. The choice has been made. We never know when death is going to happen. Sometimes sooner than we think. Sorry. But it happens. The state of man, we are all told that we will die. We are all told there will be a judgment. When we are alive, we have that opportunity to choose Jesus. Why not make that choice in your life and allow Jesus to be the ruler and guidance? Allow him to share that ultimate victory with you. Let's stand and sing our hymn of invitation to Savior's Way.